Every day, we work to build an inspiring capital that is a source of pride for all Canadians.
Chaque jour, nous travaillons à bâtir une capitale inspirante qui est source de fierté pour tous les Canadiens.
What a lovely audience you are. Radiant smiles, plenty of encouraging energy. It's a pleasure to be here. Good evening, bonsoir, kwei. I would like to begin my remarks by recognizing that I'm speaking to you today on the traditional territory of the Algonquin Nation. D'abord et avant tout, je tiens à souligner que nous sommes ici en territoire traditionnel de la Première Nation Algonquienne. The National Capital Commission values Indigenous heritage and knowledge and commits to continue working collaboratively with the Algonquin Anishinaabe Nation, as well as with other Indigenous communities to build a sustainable capital region. Je m'appelle Martin Barakengera. Je suis directeur de la planification à long terme à la CCN. C'est un plaisir de vous accueillir à la séance du Labo d'urbanisme de ce soir. Here at the NCC, we continue to walk a path of reconciliation, which includes listening and learning to strengthen our understanding of Indigenous peoples' histories, cultures, and perspectives. We are pleased to present this event to you tonight in partnership with the Canadian Institute of Planners. We welcome the representatives of the CIP National Office here this evening. I can see the faces. Thank you for supporting this event and being here with us tonight. For more information on the CIP's policies and the planning practice and reconciliation, you can visit the Institute's website, which is cip-icu.ca. Tonight, we will be exploring the topic of lessons in Indigenous planning. We will hear perspectives from Treaty 1 territory in Winnipeg, and also perspectives from communities in New Mexico. Our first speaker tonight, Dr. Ted Hohola, has a distinguished career as an educator and practitioner in urban and regional planning, with a particular specialty in Indigenous planning. Since 1980, he has taught at the University of New Mexico. He served as Director of Native American Studies and later as the Director of the Community and Regional Planning Program. In 2010, he obtained funding for iArchitecture, an interdisciplinary course on contemporary Indigenous architecture at the University of New Mexico. He has an ongoing cultural consultancy with the Native American Cultural Center at Northern Arizona State University and Studio Ma Architects. Dr. Hohola's discussion this evening will examine how Indigenous communities in the United States are utilizing design and planning practices to meet the challenges resulting from urbanization. Our second speaker will be David Thomas. He is Anishinaabe, a member of Peguis First Nation, and a graduate of the Master of Architecture program at the University of Manitoba. David draws from lived experiences as a First Nations person to create First Nations architecture and public art. He is the planning and design manager for Treaty 1 Development Corporation, which is transforming the former Kapyong Barracks in Winnipeg into Naawe Odena, one of the largest urban reserves in Canada. His discussion tonight is titled Reclaiming Space, Integrating Lived Experiences with Indigenous Urban Planning and Architecture. I want to take this time to thank our speakers and all of you for joining us this evening for this important discussion. I will now invite Tony Quedant, elder from Kitigan Zibi Anishinaabe, to formally open our discussion with his words. Thank you, Tony. Thank you. Merci, Miigwech. I think here is better so people online can follow you. I know the anticipation.
Bojo, my ingin accusers tas nikas. Adek to them. Obejiko kang danjiba. What I just said was my spiritual name as an indigenous person and the clan that I belong to as an indigenous person. And where I'm from initially is from Treaty 3, as I believe he mentioned. And but I reside in Kitigan Zibi, and she's my wife, Shirley. And what I'm supposed to perform here is a smudge. I'm just gonna light it, I'm gonna do the same thing as what my other colleague that just did, acknowledging that we're on Algonquin unceded territory here on the lands that Ottawa occupies. And that, me doing it as no Ojibwe person, me having my partner at my side, so that's my connection to the unceded, being with the Algonquin Nation. And I've been in that community for about 40 years, but it's, and so, as well, like I am a residential school survivor of 13 years. And that the many things that has happened to us indigenous people for years. And as we start trying to make our way to reconciliation with us indigenous people, I hope within my lifetime, whatever amount of time I'm still here on this planet, that I see some progress with the government and my peoples of Canada. So I'm gonna probably just light up the smudge, and we're not gonna smudge everybody individually, because it's gonna take too much time. And I'm probably gonna let my wife say a little bit of words here, because she's the Algonquin from Kitigan Zibi. So I'll pass it on to her, and so I don't know whether maybe she'll do the smudging. I don't know. Okay.
5 minutes. Okay. They turn off the sprinklers between 6:40 and 6:50. Right? Is that what it is, Natasha? Okay. So, Kwe, my name is Shirley Kamanda from Kitigan Zibi. Mishkikin Kwes, Dijnikas, means young turtle woman. That means that the turtle means to be at home within myself or wherever I am. That's how I've been. Wherever I go, I have my shell, and I am at home within myself wherever I am. So I want to say welcome to all of you to Algonquin territory. I took a course last year and learned through some reading some articles that our ancestors are really all around us in our, in Ottawa, the area around here on this territory. I found out that our Algonquin ancestors were buried around here, and now for some reason, I'm not sure how, the graves were dug up and they were used to for sand and mortar for the Parliament buildings. So this is really, it's very hurtful to know that, you know, this is what it is. So to me, I'm at home within myself because I know my ancestors are here, our elders are here, our people are here that have, you know, that lived here, that had families here, that grew their food here, that hunted here, that fished here. They're here, our ancestors. So I'm really happy for that, and that they're here, and they're watching. They're in this process of what you're doing here in Ottawa and the area for urban Indigenous planning. So, yeah, I can't look at the Parliament buildings. I see them differently now since I learned that, and I pray for them. Chimiigwech.
So now we'll just probably just go around a circle and I'll just smudge it, and we're just basically pretty well finished our little session with the...
Which he was told to keep it short and sweet because he could have take over the agenda.
You're back on stage again.
Thank you very much, Tony and Shirley. Chimiigwech. For our audience who's been who's watching from online, pardon me, just to say that we've all experienced a very intimate ceremony here, where Tony has taken the shell and the smudging and the tobacco to go around the room and to smudge each of us who are here. We hope that you at home are feeling that that sense of welcome into the space and the blessing that brings. So thank you so much. With that, I want to thank Martin for the words of introduction, to our colleagues again at CIP, who are our co-sponsors for tonight, and And again, thank you, Tony and Shirley, for your, for bringing us into the space in such a lovely way. My name is Andrew Sacred. I am the chief of planning and design here at the NCC. It's really a pleasure to be here this evening with all of you. I'm going to be your host and moderator for the discussion today. And the format that we're going to take tonight is to have each of our speakers, Dr. Ted Hohola and then David Thomas, speak one after the other, and then we'll have a moderated discussion. So I'll start off with a few questions, and then at some point open that up to you. So we've got a couple of microphones that are set up for that. So when we do questions, please go to the microphone. Keep your comments and questions fairly brief so that we can have a good discussion with our speakers. Et vous pouvez parler et poser des questions dans la langue de votre choix. Alors, nous sommes capables de traduire les questions si nécessaire. So we'll keep the questions for the end. And now I'd really love to welcome Dr. Ted Hohola to the podium to give his speech for tonight. So merci.
Thank you, Andrew. Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for my new relatives of this land for hosting me. When I was introduced to Shirley said that her husband was short and sweet. So I guess that kind of completes that comment. But I'm really happy to be here to kind of share the results of basically a lifelong journey in terms of thinking about how we can rethink our whole notion of how it is that we go about engaging with our community. And essentially the topic that I'm going to be talking about is this notion of placemaking. And it's really essentially a conversation that we've had with many other Indigenous communities through an institute that I established in 2012 at the University of New Mexico called the Indigenous Design and Planning Institute. And basically our mission is how do we use culture and identity to help inform community development? Because the challenge that we face is that for too long we've been subjected to outsiders telling us who we are and how we're supposed to behave and how it is that we're supposed to deal with developing our communities. And unfortunately, the legacy of that is that oftentimes those solutions actually end up compounding the problems that we have. So our goal has really been to work within communities to empower them in order to take over that decision-making process and do it in a way that is informed by traditional knowledge. So place knowing essentially really comes from the conversations of how it is that we need to essentially walk the land. Because in presentations that we've had with our community people, many of the elders themselves have articulated the challenge the best, which is how do we not be able to continue our survival unless we walk the land with our children? Because if they don't walk the land, then they won't learn the meanings, they won't learn the story, they won't learn the songs, they won't learn the ceremony, and that's so important in terms of maintaining the vitality and building the sense of resiliency within our own communities. And oftentimes, from the Euro-Western perspective, that has always been couched in terms of what's called placemaking. I think many of my colleagues are attuned to that. But in our conversations, the communities have basically said, well, our places are already made. But how is it then that we know about our places in a way then that bring that meaning and a sense of our understanding of the world around the places that are near and dear to us? Earlier, I think David had indicated that one of the things that is so important to us is to be able to define what we call the heart place, the idea that we have this enormous connection to our places that we become ultimately the stewards of. And in this depiction that you see right here, this represents essentially our Pueblo worldview. It's based on the sacred directions, it's based on the riparian system, it's based on the ecology, the cyclical nature of our seasons. All of those essentially help to frame what it is that is our understanding of the places that we inhabit and our responsibility to continue that.
So what are we looking
at? I want to share this short clip.
So this is the passing of the seeds wampum belt. And this is the seeds passing from generations to generations and from people to people. And then this is the seeds coming down and being planted into the earth mound. And it's not just that we're passing along the seeds, but we're passing along the information, the skills and knowledge of how to care for those seeds and to grow them and to save them and to be able to hand them to the next person.
So this Mohawk person, a sea keeper from the Tondonega Nation here in Canada. And what she's talking about is so important as represented in this of how it's not just necessary in order to impart this planting of these seeds in terms of keeping and retaining the vitality of corn, but that what's just as important is the knowledge then that's passed from generation to generation. And that traditional knowledge then is what it is that keeps these seed stocks alive. And it's important from the standpoint of thinking about how it is that we think about longevity and generation planning. And it's within that kind of perspective that we also have been struggling from our ancestral viewpoint, how it is that we translate that in terms of ancestral places. So this is a basic schematic of a very important ancestral site. That's in called Pueblo Bonito in Chaco Canyon, for those of you that have been to New Mexico. But if you actually look at the site itself, you see this amazing complex village that was brought forth by our ancestors. And it represents essentially the epitome of all of our science and understanding. You can see within the structure itself, orientations for the lunar, the solstice. There's a duality there. The sacred round kivas represent the Pleiades as well as the Milky Way. And there's other things there that essentially speak to the fact that this science was so important in terms of how it is that we manifested things, that it still is represented even to this day in terms of that engineering marvel and the manifestation of what it is that can come from traditional knowledge. Today, we use that in order to impart the notion of seven generations, because a lot of people don't understand and know that it took 140 years to construct, and the archaeological evidence actually shows that it was done in seven phases. So if you do the math, that's approximately 20 years per phase, which is a generation. And we bring that discussion to bear by getting everybody here, for example, to imagine that you're of the middle generation. And those that preceded you are your parents, your grandparents, and your great-grandparents. And those that will succeed you are your children, your grandchildren, and your great-grandchildren. And that somewhere in terms of how it is that the earliest people began to put this in motion, that they themselves did not live long enough to actually see a completion, but what a wonderful testimony to the fact that somehow their vision was able to be sustained over the countless generations or the successive seven generations that would be coming afterwards. So this is the kind of thing that we try to impart in our communities that we talk with, is that many of the things that challenge us currently are things that we have inherited, and it's going to take successive generations in order to be able to change those, and that if we don't start working on it right now, then we won't succeed in terms of how to manifest that vision in the way that we want to think about our sense of healthy community. So the other component that is also key to the conversation is the notion of circle. And this is somewhat universal in many of our Indigenous communities, the idea of life circle, the idea that as we ourselves move in our lifetime, that it can be represented by the completion of that circle. And what we do then is to sort of contemplate and think about then, what does that life journey itself amount to? And how then do we interact collectively in order to be able to work together in order to bring coherence to what it is that we do? So this example of how we apply that is from Isleta del Sur, which is a Pueblo community that is in El Paso, Texas. And they brought us a specific task to talk about how we could assist them in developing a cultural corridor plan. And in that conversation, we began by asking them, well, what are the most important values then that you have? And how is it that they fit into any kind of life journey which you move forward towards? And in that conversation, we began to reveal the notion of that life cycle, that life journey. And the way that we began to interpret this was to say, take a point on that circle that becomes a tangent point, and then take that circle and move it at a constant rate across a horizontal line. And that point then, as it moves through this progression, maps out that sine curve that you see. So this particular animation shows exactly how that progresses. So as a person then moves through their life cycle, then they go into a completion. And at the end of that, then they move on to the next generation who will assume their roles and responsibility. So if you look at the way then that this is drawn, then you see that red sine curve representing those that are born, those that are teenagers, those that are parents, those that are elders, and those that pass on. And that within each successive point within their life journey, then they learn things from their language to their roles, to their leadership, to their parenting, to their understanding of history. And ultimately they become then the most important teachers in their elder years. And as they move through that, then the question that arose within our conversation is then how does the community then help to validate and reinforce that? And that's the horizontal line. That's the light bulb moment that came into the community when suddenly then they realized that, yes, they have a multi youth program for their younger people. They have a program, leadership development program for their youth. They have their agriculture where they bring in their parent and life skills. And then they were thinking of planning an elderly center for the elderly people within their community. But what it represented was the staging of these institutions in a way then that changed and shifted that conversation in a profound way, saying that these institutions are not disassociated, but combine their necessary in order to make sure that all their people will have the best potential and learning as they move through the community, through their life cycle. And that's the role, and that's the collective mission of all of these institutions then that the tribe itself maintains. So in the conversation, we then moved on to then how is this represented within your community and your territory? And to get away from this idea that this is a monolithic kind of place, that in fact there's lots of diversity that's represented within the cultural and the geographic landscape, and that all of these elements could be used in a way to build a design that people themselves will respect, and get away from this notion of putting up this kind of signage which nobody respected anyway, saying that you're trespassing or obey our laws, which was brought originally to us in terms of what was not working, and saying instead you can take your land and transform it in a way, even through basic design, to tell people that this is a special place, that this is a heart place that has to be respected on its own terms and within its own community auspices. So here's a vacant property that they had, and here's how we began to model this kind of approach in terms of public safety, in terms of architectural design, in terms of elements which were important symbolically for them, and then representing it within this particular sphere. And you can barely see it, but make sure that we're consistent. There's even a res dog there that's kind of lying there, really happy. So the other aspect of this then was taking your basic assets, which were essentially the water systems that still exist. And on the left-hand side, you see that they basically have been denuded because they haven't been used like their ancestors had done. And one of the messages then that we brought forth in our discussion was transform those back into the ways that they were. Take them and develop a canopy for controlling the heat island effect, develop walkways along these systems, bring back agriculture and reintroduce healthy food into the systems, and use this as a way then in order to transform it back to the way that their ancestors had originally envisaged their lives in this area. So this particular portrait is actually hanging within their tribal council office, and it's a very romanticized view of what their past was, what their ancestors had. And our basic message was to say, we know you can't go back to this because we have modernized and we do things differently, but that's not to say that we can't envisage ourselves in a way that we can transform it using this as a way to identify the values which are going to be important as you grow forward. And finally, this is a painting that was done by a 12-year-old child from one of our Pueblo communities. And he probably nailed it as best as we can from a kind of graphic standpoint. He drew this diagonal roadway, which basically represents the choices that people make. And he basically articulated that if you make the right choices that are based on your culture and your identity, that you'll remain verdant, as you see on the upper left-hand side. But if you disavow those and you go towards straight capitalism and individualism, then you desertify your environment. And you can see right there that the casino is right in the nexus of this. So that essentially is a way to kind of think about how we begin to frame and conceptualize this. We work with our young people within design, architecture, and now landscape architecture. And thank you. If you'd like to contact us, this is my information here, but I'm hoping that in the question and answer period, I can answer any of the kinds of things that I've raised in this particular conversation. So, Hao, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ted. You brought some very lovely concepts in that with the life the sine curve that shows the life stages and various other images that we'll explore a little further in the discussion afterwards. I'd now love to invite David Thomas to come and give his speech about the work going on in Nawe, Odina. Thanks.
Hello, I'm David Thomas. I'm from Pegwis First Nation in Manitoba, and really honored to be here tonight and do a little talk about the work that we've been doing in Treaty One. A bit of history on what we're doing, and myself, I'm a graduate of Faculty of Architecture at University of Manitoba. Been working in architecture and public art for almost 20 years, and
I had various roles, different architects and different planners and or different clients that I've been working with. And one of them happened to be Treaty One, and I was asked to put together a graphic for this site. And I knew of the project, but I just jumped at the opportunity to be able to be a part of the project. So the former spokesman for Treaty One asked me to put together a graphic that would illustrate what the project was about. And it was 160 acres of a military base that was turned over to the First Nations. And there was a bit of mystery, I guess, for what the project would be like, and what people, the neighboring community didn't know what it would be. And so what I did was I just took the some of the forms around the site, and I folded it back into the site and created a graphic. And that basically was the master plan for about a year. And I kept being asked to update that and try some ideas on that. And, you know, it was just a little exercise, graphic exercise, but it eventually led me to working with Treaty One. And eventually we started a planning process with Mike Scatliff's firm, Scatliff Miller Murray in Winnipeg. And they worked over 18 months with Treaty One and Canada Lands in developing the site. So my primary role now is really taking a lot of that information and researching some of the different aspects of the plan, and working with the City of Winnipeg and also our First Nation communities. So Treaty One is made up of 7 First Nations in southern Manitoba and approximately 30,000 members in those communities. So we have a governing council who oversee the planning and the management of, well, the site was converted to reserve in December. So it's a brand new reserve. And it's 160 acres, and roughly 60 acres of it belongs to Canada Lands. And they'll be developing it, and they have other sites in Alberta that they've developed, and they basically just sell it off and it becomes part of the city. So I'll go through some graphics here. So the land, there was a, this is under the Treaty Land Entitlement Act. So there was, I think there was about a 16-year process in obtaining the land and having it turned over to the First Nation, which involved the courts. And eventually that happened, and it was completed, and we started some engagements within the First Nations, and this led to the master plan. And I'll just mention briefly, as I was saying, the project itself had a sense of mystery because people didn't know what. In Winnipeg, there is a small urban reserve. There's two of them. One is outside the city, and one is about, I think it's about just under 3 acres. So people didn't really, it's not a prominent site, so there was no real reference point on what a reserve would be. 160 acre site would be, and is actually part of some of the wealthiest land in Winnipeg. And people didn't really have a reference point. So we had a COVID hit just when we were gonna have public engagement sessions in the community. And then we had everything planned out, and then, you know, then that March everything happened. So we switched to a virtual presentation. So we organized a Zoom meeting, and we advertised it. And we had 800 people join the Zoom call, which was really incredible. And 60% of those people were from the neighborhood where the site is. So we had a 1-hour presentation, and before that meetings where we would, or we had a poll in the community, and we had, I think it was like 30 or 40% approval rating for the project. But once we had the information going out and people understood what the project was about, that went up to, I think it was something like 85%. And at one point we had focus groups, and we had like a one-way mirror, so we can watch people and we listen to them. hear them talk about what their idea of a reserve was. This was before we the presentation. So we learned a lot. And so we finished the master plan after 18 months, and the initial part of that was asking ourselves the question of what would our grandchildren say? What do we want our grandchildren to say about the site and this development? So it became like a personal question for our staff, and then we took that forward to the communities and got feedback from them. And but that question really became made the project. It became personal, and you know, I have four children, so I started thinking about, you know, their children, and which they don't have yet. But we started to like really look at that, and it, and for me personally, it started becoming something more personal to myself, like being like one of the few designers like in Canada. Like at that time, I guess, well, there's quite a few now, but learning and trying to find a place for myself as a designer where I'm creating like change, positive change, and having an impact in some meaningful way with as a designer. So those questions stayed in my mind, and as we went along, I started getting more questions about how are we going to do this. So here's a graphic here of the site. You can see the image on the left. We have the gray area, which is Treaty 1. And this is now reserve land. This is Nahui Odena, Winnipeg. And the beige site is the Canada land site. So as we developed the project, we, I guess, through the negotiations, it became apparent that it was beneficial that we worked with Canada Lands, and we created a partnership. And to this day, we have a pretty good partnership with them. We cost share, we do planning exercises together, we meet with the city of Winnipeg, and we tour different sites throughout the city in different seasons, like in summer or winter, and we look at how the snow is piling up and how we're going to clean the city will take us through, and we look at, we try to learn from the city of Winnipeg. So there's an ongoing partnership and collaboration and research that we just do, Canada Lands, Treaty 1 in the city of Winnipeg. So when you look at it, it looks pretty simple. You know, there's some sites for housing, and there's some commercial development, and there's residential that is like different densities. But underlying in the site, there's a sewer that runs through the entire site, and it's like an 8-foot sewer, and that drains stormwater as well as like sewage, like it's a combined sewer. So there's already from the planning standpoint, the initial planning stage was how do we deal with a site that's been an agriculture site for like 100 years, and now we're going to put buildings there. And then where is that water going to go? And what happens now is that sewer fills up, and that water, that sewer water dumps into the Assiniboine River. So that was one of the first things that we started to look at. And along the site, there's a boulevard, Kennison Boulevard, that runs north to south on the east side of the site. So that one is being developed. And what's going to happen eventually is that there will be a separated sewer and water system along that highway, along that road, and then that'll alleviate some of the pressure that we have, I guess, or some of the issues that we have with stormwater and retention on the site. So there's a lot of long-range scheduling that has to happen. The widening of that Kennison Boulevard is, I think it's a $600 million project, and it's about 6 years. And so there's some big things that have to happen but we are now working with the city, developing parcel by parcel. So the city has been open to that. So we have a first phase that we're looking at happening within this year. I'll go a little further here, and you can see some of the images there showing some of the flavor of what we see on the site. And I guess it was a concept. We're creating a new reserve here, and then we're going to have housing and some businesses and commercial space. But then when you can say that all you want, but when you actually get down to it, it becomes so complex and so daunting, and there's so many questions, and it becomes this unwieldy project, and you have to be grounded in how you're going to approach it. So we knew that we, in a sense, we're creating a small Indigenous city. So what examples do we have to look at for that? And we didn't have any like examples really that that we could look at. So we started to try to answer these questions again, like what would we want our grandchildren to say about the site? And we started to look at those, and we realized that we had to create some design guidelines. We had to look at some principles that we can design the site. So in this image here, in this, you could see the there's a plaza there. So what would an Indigenous urban plaza or shopping area look like? Here we have artwork, murals. We have Indigenous stores, perhaps, restaurants. So like these are just, you know, these are explorations and what these spaces would be. This is actually Canada Land sites that are developed, that which are basically what they'll be doing on Nawayodina. So those questions became something that we tried to explore further in our design guidelines. So put out an RFP, and we asked for looking for planners that could help us put this together. So we had a team that came together, and they're all Indigenous architects and planners. And they spent a few months putting together some ideas and helping us sort this out. So these, what I'm showing here is phase one. And these are just some images. These, this gas station convenience store is designed. I think we're about 90% done the design work on this. And this is phase one. Here is a bit of the images showing possibly how everything will roll out over, you know, it could be 10 years, could be 15 years. And we have an infrastructure plan that divides it into three phases. So there we go. This is the kind of faded out areas of Canada Land site. So we took our aspirations, and our Indigenous planning team looked at those, and we looked at the teachings that were prevalent in our First Nation communities in Treaty 1. And we started to, well, we let them just do this work, and we just fed into it. But the Indigenous planning team took the teachings from the communities and aligned them with the aspirations that we developed a couple years before. And those teachings were applied to our Treaty 1 communities, and they started to be highlight relationships within the communities. And these were, you know, family relationships, just like different generational relationships. And then from those relationships, they started to take those relationships and turning them and looking at them as being, oh, my brain is slowing. I've been up since 3 o'clock this morning, so. But we started to take those teachings and look at them on the site, and then they started to evolve into like where would the elders sit, how far would benches be apart from each other, and we started to like turn them into three-dimensional relationships. So the design guidelines started to inform something that was happening on the site. And we started looking at storytelling and taking our 7 First Nation communities, our 7 Treaty 1 communities, and trying to find areas on the site where we could start to highlight the history of each community. And as well, like the migration story of the Anishinaabe people, the Great Migration, like how could we even talk about that on the site as well? And so all of this work started to come together, and it started creating a lot of excitement within Treaty 1. And personally, myself looking at it, looking at the work and how we were going to do this, I had a lot of questions in myself as a designer. And one of them was that I was working with Assiniboine Park in Winnipeg on a diversity garden. And it was it turned out to be a 7-year project. But when I started on that project, a knowledge keeper, David Blacksmith from Manitoba, he told me, he said, Dave, when you're working as a designer, you have to change your energy. You can't just see yourself as a man doing this work in our communities because it's off balance. You can't just do this and think that a man's going to do all this work. You have to have a woman beside you, and you have to start from this day and change that energy up. So I had three women that were designers that I contacted, and we just start working together. And from that day, I've always been working with women on projects. And it's kind of like ironic that a man has to come and say that and bring that up. But it's worth doing because it changed how I saw myself as a designer, and it changed how I looked at all of my work I had done up to that time, because I worked with my daughter and I started to notice where I would, like, she graduated from architecture. She's 32 years old. I was working with her and I started to notice where I talked over her or I cut her off when she was talking. And I started to notice where other men would do that. And I started seeing this invisible kind of thing appear where there was an unbalance, there was this imbalance in how things were done and how decisions were made. And even our perception of what design issues we're dealing with, they're not fully revealed to us because we're looking at it through a male lens. So that started to really open my eyes, and I started looking at all the projects I did over almost 20 years, and I started realizing that my work has been disconnected from my community, and it's been disconnected from my family, and me with like the privilege that I have with my education and the growth that I've gone through and experience, I'm doing myself a disservice because I've been disconnected. And a lot of it is because of the imbalance that exists in society, eh? And when I have people who contacted me about land acknowledgements and they say, what can we do? And you know, some people will say, well, acknowledge that you're a settler company and acknowledge the benefits and the privileges that you've got from the resources of First Nation communities throughout history. But I say that we should look at, as men, we should look at how we treat women. And I think, excuse me, I'm saying this because of the missing Indigenous women and the impacts that it's had. And I think that that's proof that our perspective on our how we interact, it's off balance. So that goes into the design realm, into the planning realm, and into the work that we do as designers, because design is, in a sense, ceremony. It is cultural production. It is as important as language and communicating, because before there was written word, we had our bodies, we had our things that we created to tell stories in dance and our regalia. And those are the things that design comes from for Indigenous people. It is actually reclaiming ceremony. So those are my findings, I would say, in this process of Nawe Odina and understanding what design is. So our discussions earlier with Ted, we talked about design, some of the design principles that he's presented, they're excellent, perfect examples of good design. But I would just say, as an Indigenous person and a designer and talking from lived experiences, that layer of understanding, reclaiming the ceremony of design and how we look at creating is part of a healing process, is part of reconciliation. And that's the missing piece that I'd just like to share tonight. And that's basically what I wanted to get to, that the design guidelines and the process, the learning curve that I've been going through the journey has really been revealing some truths to me. And some of them are really, you know, there are kind of power situations that happen. And it's how do we, those are the real questions that we have to like ask ourselves. You know, I when I think of the next like, generation of young people, I always think that they have something, they have advantages that I never had. And like my 10-year-old son has things that I never had when I was 40 years old. And I think that what we, our responsibility and role as an older generation, or whoever's older here, like me, is we have to respect the position that the younger people, the younger designers, the younger First Nation youth, we have to respect them and give them the space that they need to do things their way. Within Treaty One, we have a youth committee in the seven communities. We have knowledge keepers and language committees. And like those are built into Treaty One as a developer. And those are attempts to put these relationships back in place within our organization. And we're a developer. Like it's, I think that's a really different model for a developer. So those are my thoughts. Thank you.
Am I on? Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much, David. That's a lovely presentation and gives us fertile ground for further conversation. I'll have a few questions just to kind of start us off with the discussion, and I will at one point invite folks to pose some questions. You can go to the microphones for that, or if you're online, can pose questions in the YouTube chat, and we'll have a way to introduce those into the conversation. Okay, and as I had said before, vous pouvez poser des questions en français. Nous sommes capables de les introduire dans la conversation aussi. So, first question is for you, Ted. With your experience in education, working with planning professionals who are generally at the beginning of their careers, you see anything that needs to change with respect to learning about Indigenous perspectives in land use planning and design programs?
There is a lot that needs to be changed because we're basically working with a perspective that essentially has always been used to trying to transform us into the other. So architecture, design essentially has been situated in terms of the idea that there's an expert who somehow knows and is knowledgeable and therefore then comes up with a design. And oftentimes when it's presented to the community, it's already a fiat accompli, it's already done. They're just looking for their affirmation. And if there's no affirmation, it just kind of falls on deaf ears. So our process really is how do you engage community in order to be able to build that representation of the voices. And that includes all the seven generations, just as David had indicated. We need to listen to the women, we need to listen to the elders, we need to listen to the children, because they essentially will work in concert with one another in order to be able to make the best in terms of a comprehensive approach, because every one of those folks are stakeholders in terms of looking at their notion of vision into the future. So that's essentially why, in a sense, we're staged to be in the belly of the beast, so to speak, because we want to be able to nurture our young people who are going to be our future designers and planners and landscape architects to assume these roles in a way that is really culturally and community responsible. So we're developing a whole different pedagogy, nomenclature, language in order to be able to enable them to be to deal with that. And it has to essentially not only impact and affect us, but also in that process, there could be a way to influence the larger non-Native community as well too, because the challenges that mainstream has are just as enormous or even more enormous in some instances, especially with the kinds of challenges that are coming as a result of us being challenged in terms of our sustainability and resiliency through things like climate change, for example. I mean, coming here and seeing the whole city enveloped in smoke, seeing our forests then succumbing to these kinds of management processes that we've had to endure all of these years, and not integrating traditional knowledge into the stewardship of this. These are all elements that I think we can bring together in that conversation.
Thank you.
David, in Dr. Hohola's presentation, there was this notion of place knowing. And I wondered if you might be able to comment a little bit on sort of knowing the place and how that shaped some of the design work that had has happened at Ngawi Odina.
Well, I think that in our case of Treaty One, we have a we have a language keeper. Like, we have a base of language keepers within Treaty One, and we also have on staff within Treaty One Development Corporation, we have three language people. So I guess earlier on, I remember we were talking about our communities, and we started to, we would state which community we were from, but then the language keepers would say it in a different way. It would be more descriptive to the land. So there was this whole other world that kind of opened up when we started to really work with them within Treaty One, that it really changed our sense of place. And so I think that the language, and myself, I'm not a language speaker. I understand certain parts of it. I could kind of catch, and I'm learning, but hopefully I'm wise enough to know that I could say that there's something there that really unlocks the relationships to the land, and I believe that's in the language. And when we have there's a certain kind of connection that you could sense when we're on the site. We have ceremonies on our site now, and we have like gatherings, and there's connections there that happen that are, like, before I grew up driving by there and it was a military base. But now when we drive on the site, and we had last week we had an event, it seems like it's like home, like something has changed. And it is like when we have the teepees up and there's a fire and there's singers, and there's like something that it really resonates that we've had all our lives basically in our communities, but now it's happening on the site. So there's a transformation that is really powerful, yeah. Especially when it's rush hour and we had our staff on the site 3 weeks ago, and we walked the whole 160 acres and we filled up 55 garbage bags. And as we were going along the street, there was cars driving by honking, just like, really encouraging us that we're doing something that and there's a sense that we've been covered pretty much every inch of the site now, just like picking, cleaning it and that. So there's like Ted had mentioned walking, taking the children and walking them on the land, and I feel like we're starting a process like that on our site right now.
What would be some of the things that you see non-Indigenous planners or policymakers that need to keep in mind when they are working with Indigenous communities on land use planning and design projects? Any insights on that?
Well, of course it is. It is really having engagement from the community, and you know, it's a tricky thing. I've been in presentations where, as a First Nation person, I've been with Chief and Council, and I'm talking, and I know they're not listening to me at all. You know, there's a certain kind of rhythm or timing that where it's right, it's time right to speak. And I think, like, for myself, when I came out of school, you know, you're taught a certain way to do presentations, but then over time, I learned that you have to adjust, and you have to be wiser than, you have to unlearn, I guess. So there was that level of presentation where you're just in a room, where you learn when to speak. You learn when you're engaged, when it's right to speak. But I think in a larger scale, what we've done is we have our youth group within Treaty One, and we have our knowledge keepers, our language keepers, and that really integrates the communities into Treaty One. And like, we are the designers, like we have designers on staff, and so that the work that we're doing is really bringing the people, like it's the community members who are actually, there's Treaty One community landscape architects and planners within Treaty One, and they're actually from the community. So like, we're doing it for ourselves, but like keeping that engagement happening is really important. Like with, like we had a youth conference 2 weeks ago, and we had it on another urban reserve within Winnipeg, and there was something like 80 youth there, and it was on a weekend where like Manitowabi Powwow, where there's like 6,000 people coming from like Arizona, New Mexico, California, all over. Like it's a massive like powwow, but yet there was still a room full of young people showing up at our youth conference, Treaty One Youth Conference. And that was really amazing that like this crowd of young people would just show up and be there every day. It had happened on the weekend. And so I think that we have because we're a First Nation developer, and we have Treaty One Nation as well, that is the oversight body of the Treaty One Development Corporation, that we're doing it ourselves. So there's a certain, like, the extension of the community is right within the Development Corporation itself. So that's pretty unique, though. It's a tough question, though.
Fair enough. Do you want to add on to that?
Yeah, to say that it's a really tough question, because obviously one of the things that we always have to address from my perspective is non-natives coming in saying, you know, what can we learn of Indigenous planning, and is it only about you? And in that sense, we try to dispel that and basically say that it should be a concern of any place-based community. And in fact, in the way that we model our ideas, we talk about how if a community lives in a place for successive generations, they naturally evolve a worldview, which is understanding their role, their place, their ideas, their values as associated with that, which then becomes the heart of resiliency and sustainability. I think that in terms of urbanization, we become too complacent in terms of our relationships to places. We go by the credo of use it and abuse it and then leave and go somewhere else. I mean, even from the perspective of education, people look at it as you attain education in order to become more mobile rather than becoming smart about the places where you're at. And I think that how it is then that we think about ourselves as we move through our life cycles is really important to understand, where is it within that life cycle that your role and your responsibilities emanate forth in a way that builds that sense of responsibility. So that's a life lesson that's not just specific to our Indigenous people, but I think it's important for everyone And if we can get to that level of reasoning, then I think that we can really begin to get serious about the kind of challenges that we're all facing at this point of time.
Very true. While you speak of life cycle, it was a very interesting graphic that you put in your presentation, Ted, about the various stages of life and that they're modeled on that sine curve. What further meaning could you comment on with that particular diagram and what it means for our various responsibilities to our communities as we move through time?
Yeah. I think it's just a way of kind of dealing with resonating our understanding of time, and that time essentially then can be represented not just from a horizontal longitudinal plane, but that we can find that we understand more. We think about how it is that we go through cycles. Even nations go through cycles of development and decline. And as people, we also go through cycles of elevation and decline as well, too. And as we all are moving as a collective, then we stage ourselves in terms of where we fit within these, and then apportion our own ways of being able to involve and interject ourselves in a way that's really purposeful and meaningful in terms of how we go about doing what it is that we do. And that's really, I think, the value and why I am so committed and excited to our professions of design and planning, because we're a discipline that is totally immersed in this notion of future. And I know that we as Native people have been subjected to these processes where we've been transformed into the other, as I indicated. But in order to be able to break out of that, we also have to stage it from the standpoint of acknowledging this, but also now thinking, how are we going to move on from that? What is it that really that future is going to be? And how do we then develop that kind of clear vision as based on this kind of cycle of where it is that we're at, so that we're staging ourselves to begin things, admit to the fact that we may not live long enough to see it completed, but whatever it is that we do is so compelling that then the successive generations continue that work. Because everything that is placed with us right now that we've inherited has not come overnight. You know, there's that adage of Rome wasn't built in a day. Well, generations, in a sense, are in the same sort of situation. It's going to take generations for us to undo many of the kinds of things that have impacted our communities. But if we don't start now, if we don't begin to articulate what it is that that vision is, and if we collectively don't begin to subscribe to it, then we're not going to be any better off down the future. So thinking and using a whole different way of even relating and not thinking in terms of these artificial time frames like what planners use, which is, you know, let's talk about 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 25, 20, 200, that's meaningless. But if you then orient that conversation to your children, your grandchildren, and your great-grandchildren, then it builds that connection. And suddenly it's not abstract anymore. And I think that's the way that, you know, we basically seed and nurture how it is that we have that kind of meaningful dialogue.
Very profound.
Wow.
I'm taking the words from David's mouth.
I'd love to take an opportunity to take a couple of questions from our audience. I think we've got a...
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you, Dr. Hohola. Thank you, David, for your presentations. We have... yes, applause. We have Councillor Merv Sarazin here from Algonquins of Pickwackinigan First Nation, who would like to ask the first question.
Oh, miigwech. Hoikakina, bonjour, hello, bonjour. Indigenous cause, Pickwackinigan and Don Jiba, Waba Mayenga and Dotem. Thank you for the invitation. I was I'm happy to be here, and I'm really glad I had a chance to meet both of these gentlemen, David Thomas and Ted. Instantly, I connected with David Thomas from the Peguis Reserve. We shared a little bit of our history and journey. I'm from the Algonquin Territory, as you know, from up the highway, about 2 hours at the Pequawkinagon, they call it, the Algonquins of Pequawkinagon First Nation. And we've got about 3,000 members in our band. But on reserve, we're about 450 people. But I spent the last 30 plus years running the reserve almost like an Indian agent. Coming from that era, I think I was the second band manager to hire 30 some years ago to change the reserve, which was initially, it was wooded lots. A lot of them are wooded lots, gravel roads. Everybody had their garbage in their own backyards. But I was happy. I was living in Ottawa. I was, you know, a graduate of business admin, working in government. You know, I had a pretty good paying job, and then chief and council came to Ottawa to dig me out of the rubble over here to say, you got to come home and help us because we don't have modern planners and thinkers like yourself that understand government and the machinery of government, how we can get money back in our community and overhaul our whole community. So if anybody been up the highway to Pequawkinagon, it's different than it was 30 years ago. It's more modern. Houses are better, our community buildings are better, but we brought our design of our health center and the design of our daycare center was based on our culture. The daycare is essentially, we're birch bark canoe builders, that's who we're known for. And so the designers back then, they used that idea of a tipped over birch bark canoe, and they designed our daycare after that. Our health center was based on our culture and belief system in the Thunderbird and the Eagle. And the design of the health center was based on an eagle. From an aerial view, when you look down on it, you could see the entrance is where the beak of the eagle is. And when you walk in, and then the wings are where the offices are, and a circular room at the back is our meeting rooms. But those awards were done by a company here in Ottawa, and they rank pretty high. And when you talk about designers and engineers, their designs were in the top 10 of about 270 some entrants. So it was quite an honor to be a part. But listening to David, listen to Ted, and how they work with the people in their communities and look at their culture, their history. We did a lot of the similar kind of things, but it's difficult keeping everybody together, right? It's everybody's got different ideas, and you come to a collective idea that here's what we wanted, what the elders wanted, what the young people wanted, what our community people wanted, and that's sort of where we're at today. And but the most interesting thing about meeting David and his work with the Capion Army Base, I can't get the name of the name you've changed it to, but we're essentially doing the same thing here in Ottawa. We're going to create an extension to our reserve within the city of Ottawa. It's something I've been working on with former Chief Wendy Jocko. When you talk about a male and a female working together, well, I'm following the female's lead and trying to create this reserve in the city. We have opportunity and we're still working on it. I'm at it now 2 years. Wendy didn't get elected, but still I'm carrying on that initiative and working with the complexities of government. David spoke a lot about how to keep CLC in the mix, how to keep public service procurement services in the mix, how to keep Indigenous Services Canada in the mix, how to keep the City of Ottawa in the mix. So there's a lot of players involved in creating an additional reserve. So we're way at that, we're right in that mix now, keeping all the wheels moving. And then what government things change, right? ADMs change, directors of programs changes, so we need to, the chief changed, so now I'm the only kind of constant person in the planning that I'm now engaging our new chief, Greg Sarazen, and our new EDO, executive director, Lisa Maness, in the picture, so we're feeding them information to pursue an endeavor like you did in Winnipeg there, David. In fact, we like I mentioned, we hired the same lawyer that was involved in it, so we bring that kind of experience into the process, really. So, but I don't have any real questions. I'm really impressed with what I'm seeing here tonight, but both gentlemen, both presenters, and it's a deep thinking. Miigwech.
I'd like to say, though, that we do have, within Treaty 1, we had three elections in a row. So we have to, like, we had three new chiefs and councillor, like many new councillors. So there's kind of a process that has to happen where we have to introduce them to the project again. So it takes many months for them to, you know, they're just new in leadership, but they have to absorb that and then as well learn about another reserve. Like, they're not only their own reserve, but there's another reserve they have to be, they're part of running too, eh? So there is those complexities of leadership change that we deal with too. Yeah.
And I was really impressed by what it is that you just outlined until you said lawyer. The necessary evil. But yeah, I think, you know, that's part of the challenge that we all face, because our basic status is much different than find in terms of any other types of organizations, because certainly in my part of the world, we still have embodied both secular and traditional leadership. And oftentimes it's really a back and forth in terms of how it is that you build an affirmed consensus. But that's one of the things that we've been staging within ourselves, is what our role as planners is, being facilitators in that, but also keeping our eyes wide open to make sure that we adhere and understand those kinds of protocols that are really necessary to making sure that we don't end up creating divisions, which already exist anyway, but, you know, certainly exacerbating the situation.
Great, thank you. I think we've got time for maybe one or, pardon me? We'll have another one question. Could you please go to the microphone? Oh. Do you have a question, sir? We have time. You were next. If you okay. Yeah.
That's pretty dramatic what you did, though.
That was a little scary. That, I mean, you did have one question, so I'm happy to defer. So thank you so much, both of you. This is really a pleasure and part of a much longer learning process for me. I guess I have two questions. I mean, we hear Canada Lands, we hear disposition of federal properties, we hear land back. I think of the NCC and I think of the whole Green Belt. I think of Canada Lands and all the properties that they're dealing with all the time too. And when can we have a dialogue about what that could be, what the Green Belt could be, for instance? And that's a sort of an open question. But related to that is the fact that cities in Canada are becoming, you know, greater and greater proportions of the Indigenous population are moving into cities, and we have an extremely heterogeneous, it's Inuit, it's First Nations, it's Métis, but all the differences within each of those groups too. So the groups that we're serving within, and then we have the traditional land on which we're sitting. So how do you create community? How do you deal with land? How do you maintain connection to land, I guess, when so much of the Indigenous population is actually kind of moving into cities? And David, I'm really impressed that CLC is working with the community in Manitoba. I you know, that's great. And I'm really encouraged to hear that something like that might be happening in Ottawa. So I just wanted to, how do you deal with this heterogeneity? It's not only about maintaining community. To me, it's about creating community between Indigenous, different Indigenous groups, between Inuit, First Nations. We're all coming together in these cities now. That's a very open-ended question.
Well, I think that when we started to envision Ngawe Odina, when we started to envision that, we started to have feedback from the Treaty 1 communities, and there was a process where, like, there is an urban reserve in Winnipeg. It's Long Plain First Nation, and it's right beside this mall, a shopping mall that most, pretty much most popular one in Winnipeg. And there's a brand new hotel that has been built there, and it's it has like a water slide, and it's got a restaurant, and it's a coffee shop, and on the side of that hotel is a big symbol, and it's this big swoop with thunderbirds, and it's a protection symbol from Peter Yellowquill, one of the leaders from Long Plain. So the idea that there's an Indigenous space that is First Nation land, and that it has a sense of home there. People go there, and there's like business. There's even on a Sunday, the place is busy with people. And on the side of the building is this big protection symbol that represents life and death, and like afterlife, and thunderbirds, and like it's a really powerful thing. I think most people don't know actually what that is. They think it's just a graphic, but it's a really powerful symbol left from the breastplate of one of the leaders. But so the idea that there's an Indigenous urban place is a new concept. That you can, like, there's a certain vibe you have on a reserve, eh? When you walk, you go to the store, the restaurant, or gas station, everyone's gathered out, hanging out, talking, and there's a vibe, there's a sense of community. And so, like, in Winnipeg, that's a new thing in that one site. But now when we think of it expanded onto like 100 acres, and there's like this excitement that is in the communities, that it's people are just learning how to articulate that idea of this urban space where we belong, where we can, there's not this stark maybe sense of like displacement or racism or, you know, like the other kind of all those. It's actually a space where it's an urban setting that we belong in. So like there's a brand new concept to that. And I think that idea itself brings excitement. It brings people that want to be a part of that. And not only Indigenous people, but like non-Indigenous people are really excited to see that happen. And they want to be a part of it. They have ideas, they're contributing, we're always getting people coming into our office who are just like, we got an idea, like, and so there's always teams of people coming in, and so it's very inclusive, like it's an open concept that I think people are really, I'm surprised that people are ready for that and they want that. So it just presented itself, and it's very unique that this project is happening. Like I still like, I like, this is really happening. I guess I reserve now. So yeah, it has its own attraction for people that is really healthy.
Just to qualify one aspect of that though, I think we can take a lesson from a book that I co-authored called Reclaiming Indigenous Planning. It can be used in the context of reclaiming Indigenous place. Because the urban areas that we inhabit were Indigenous places. We're just reclaiming it. You know, some of our greatest cities like New York City, St. Louis, Phoenix, Tulsa, Albuquerque, all of those were originally our homelands. And through this process of colonization and settler colonialism and whatever else, we were displaced, and we haven't been acknowledged of the fact that these were originally our home territories. So it's not anything of people moving into the cities as much as affirming the fact that we've always been in these cities. And now it's basically our time and our place in order to empower our communities to be a vital and strategic part of this.
It's a powerful concept for sure. Sir, do you have a question?
Bonjour, in the name of Anim, George Anthony, Onye Wichi, Silva Desmond, Ndunjiba. I would like to just ask your concepts of futurism. I know that, I guess, speaking from someone of the African diaspora, You know, there are cases where, you know, you have things where, like Black Panther, where there's the visions of the future, but they're very much mediated by technology with a bit of disconnect into the actual cultural practices that this media draws from. I guess my question then is, how, you know, what considerations do you take into account when, you know, ensuring that while these projects are meant to persist into the future, that they don't become subsumed by those forces in, you know, and ultimately shaped by those. Thanks.
Well, I think there's a lot to be learned from our whole history of appropriation. I mean, just look at the whole mascot issue with the fact that, you know, our identities have been taken and put into this crass commercial kind of context and situation. And I think the only way in order to be able to deal with that is through education, and in particular, building a power of voice in order to be able to articulate what is wrong with this kind of appropriation, and essentially moving forward in a way that allows people to really respect who it is that our people are and the role that they assume in their understanding and their ways of being able to represent that kind of voice within the room. One of the tenets that we espouse to as part of Indigenous planning is we need no translators. And that comes out of the legacy of the fact that often when we were convened, there were always anthropologists in the crowd who basically would usurp the voices of our people and say, so this is what we heard. And in a way that is not what is necessary as far as the representation that should emit forth, because the people who were talking, who are the Indigenous voices, were talking directly, and they don't need any translator to go through that. So I think from certainly where I stand in terms of higher education and the role that I assume, the young people that we're bringing up the ranks, we're elevating them within that kind of status quo situation in order to be able to represent themselves as equals with any of the anthropologists, if we want to put it that way, in the room as well too. So it's really, really important, you know, that we have people like David, who are the practitioners with their feet on the ground, in order to be able to represent this and do it at an equal level to any power broker that comes from the city of Winnipeg. It's so important to do that, and it's so important to demonstrate that, especially for our upcoming youth in terms of positionality and being able to represent themselves and look forward to that in terms of their role as leadership.
Yeah, you brought something to mind where within our team planning the project and implementing, and there's these moments where the leadership within our office, we have people coming in and offer, well, we can do this for you, we can do that for you. And I could tell that it's paternalistic, like they think that we don't know what we're doing. And there's so many times that the work that my design team, Faith Campos and Ashley Peebles, like young ladies I work with, and Ethan, there's so many times that we've been way ahead of any consultant who's come in, way ahead of any developer, any construction company. We're way ahead in what we know what we're trying to do. And there's so many times that leadership would say, like my boss would say, we don't need them. It happens like every month someone would come in and like, we don't need them. I have emails coming in all the time for people offering services, and they show us what they're doing, but we're already way ahead of that, and we're doing it in-house. Like our digital model for our site, our animations, everything we've done, we've built. We have young people work for months building digital models, doing animation renderings, And we have those tools at our disposal. We have CAD files of every inch of the site. We were planning 65 buildings right now. We're planning how many housing units, commercial space. So that vision and that capability is built in. And along with that are those principles that we're trying to, you know, that's coming from our community. So I feel like there's a safety in that we're doing it for ourselves.
What powerful and yet, logical notions that you speak for yourselves and that you could do it for yourselves, and it doesn't need a mediation or an interpreter. Very, very profound. I wanted to ask if there were any questions from online. No. We have time for one further. Pardon me. Two more questions. Okay. So, but we'll keep them brief. So. Sir?
Can you think of a well-planned urban site or town, or can it be made to exist where there's no landfill site needed and no sewer system required?
You're talking about like a site that is off-grid, basically? Or are you talking about a site... developing a site that has no infrastructure, or
the structure is well planned, it doesn't require a sewer system or a landfill site. It all depends how it's planned.
Oh,
it may not exist, but can it exist by planning?
I think that can exist. almost anything's possible with design.
Hi. So I work at the AFN, and we recently put out a report about closing the infrastructure gap. And in that report, we found that we need, in Canada, there's needed about $1.6 billion to fill the infrastructure gap in terms of accessibility. So I just wanted to ask, what are you doing in terms of your projects and your learning to consider inclusive design and design that includes people with disabilities, people who are homeless? I recently heard a quote from an Indigenous person. I can't remember their name right now, but they recently said that 100% of Indigenous people have intergenerational trauma. And I am curious how you are thinking about building wellness and healing into your designs.
Oh man. Well, yeah, I indicated before, we have to acknowledge the fact that we are dealing with intergenerational processes. And I just actually returned from a community that we're working with, Golovin in Alaska, Native Alaskan community on the Bering Sea. And it was interesting because during part of our community conversations, they admitted that the elders, as they described them, boarding school elders, were the only ones that were left. And that the elders who they said grew up in the era where they were totally sustainable from the perspective of traditional knowledge were no longer there. And their concern is that these boarding school elders had been taken away from their communities and that they didn't know how to parent anymore because they had not been taught by their parents about these kinds of parenting skills. So from that perspective, then, we have to be, I think, really deliberate in terms of how it is that we begin to engage and interact and teach our children to learn about how to be inclusive in terms of all the different types of individuals within our community that create this kind of social fabric, and not to diminish these as based on other kinds of values that may not be really germane to how it is that we had originally built our relationships. And a lot of that conversation that's brought to bear is the the role of women, the role of men, the role of two-spirit people, all of these that essentially can be seen in terms of how do they work in harmony and how do they work collectively and how do they all equally contribute in terms of their roles, and that we shouldn't diminish any of them because of values that that are not respective and responsible in terms of our own society.
I think when you talk about like this, the infrastructure and that, like I worked for DOTC housing 1 year, and I remember that we looked at the housing need of, it was something like $75 billion. And then I think of infrastructure, like there's so many needs in the community, and those are gonna take generations to like address those issues. Like there has to be major upheaval of how Canada is structured to even address those issues. And so when our people in the communities, like one of the things, like how many of our people can even imagine having healthy housing conditions, living conditions in for everyone to have that? Like that's it, there's this concept of like that First Nations have already, they've already been through the apocalypse. Like people talk about that, and there's like a post-apocalyptic view perspective of First Nations because they've already been through where their civilization and their communities have been devastated, and they're just and left, and they're already gone through an apocalypse. So those, and then there's a concept of the idea that our people are refugees in our own land. And those are very real. When you go into a First Nation community and you go to some places, you actually see that there's generations are living as refugees. So in that, there is like mentalities, there's of how you see yourself in the future. There's like a wall, there's things that have to be broken down and have to be, there has to be a vision of things beyond. And there has to be a capability of seeing those things. And like I'm, for myself as an Indigenous man, there was a point about 5 years ago that I realized I didn't see myself a certain way. There was things that I was denied growing up in Winnipeg, that I there was gaps where I saw my non-Indigenous friends, they saw themselves flowing in certain ways that I couldn't see myself doing, and I realized there was gaps that I never had. Although I, you know, have my been to university, I've never drank or smoked. My parents were non drinkers or anything like that. Like, but there was these big gaps still. And where does that come from? Like how many of our people are young people? And I'm so thankful now. I see young people now and they have things that I never had before that I wouldn't even imagine having, like ways that they see themselves, how they communicate and how they relate to each other. There's like a sense of empowerment there. And I just hope that the next generation, like me and Ted, we're getting up there.
Yes, we're in that.
We're in that. Comes back.
I'm a little higher than he is, but.
Do I have time for one more?
Oh, yeah. A very quick question. Thank you very much, Ted, David, and Andrew. I immigrated to Canada 4 years ago, and this is a great learning for me. I have a quick question for you, David, about your experience of working on Treaty 1 Master Plan and Design. So what design elements were the most effective in translating the teachings and the principles into a unique urban form?
Well, I think we're not really, the form of it is not really something we're still in the process of searching out and understanding the values that are the values. And part of like what I just mentioned, it's like seeing the future and shooting for like a vision of it's adding something in and that into the what we see the project becoming that hasn't been done before. So we're taking pieces like I try to study from all over the world, everything I can find, and I find little pieces here and there. So like trying to put that together for our people. And I have a young team of designers I work with, and I throw out ideas, and we're always, and then as well as like other Indigenous designers across Canada and New Zealand, and even like in Norway, I just talk about ideas, and we throw ideas out to all over the place, and then people bring ideas back. And like in Manitoba, there's like 28 Indigenous planners and architects that we have a barbecue called the Ever Deadly Barbecue, and there was like 28 people last time, and they're all from Winnipeg, and they're all like, so we have like, I'm constantly like, it's, I'm feeding off of people around me, mm-hmm. and the young people. So we're trying to find a trajectory that's not the status quo. Like what possibly more could, like what can we have that is for the next generation? And like things with Ted that he's saying, like, I'm learning so much today. I learned so much from listening to him, and so we're just trying to gather ideas, and we don't have like the formal, like there was an image that I had in my presentation. It was like, it looked like this crazy curvy shape.
Yeah.
That was our work plan. It just goes in circles and it stops and it goes to like these ends and turns back. Like that's our work plan for our project. It's allowed to just exist and let itself organically become something.
It's Indigenous math.
Yeah. So like there's no like formula. It comes from another place. It comes from something that's emanating from the next generation, from my generation, from other it's like something that's emanating. And the part of us trying to get to is that envisioning our communities is like a ceremonial spiritual process, in the sense where you're finding that life that is feeding you, and you're trying to stay in that and carry that within you through the design process, so that you're always drawing from that life that you're feeling from the community. And that's the real connection. We're part of the community, and we're making our community, and we're feeding from the community, so it's going to be it'll grow from that. And I don't think that school teaches that.
Well, thank you. And I noticed one image in the presentation where the facade looked like a woven fabric kind of a thing. So is it those kind of elements which you're trying to use?
Yeah, we have some ideas.
Okay. I got my answer. Thank you.
There's like some, there's a lot of technology and different, some exciting things that designing that I see a lot of people doing. Like there's a lot of young designers now that I see, and I'm just like, oh, I wanted to do this for 20 years and these people are doing this now. So, yeah.
Well, we're heading towards the end of our evening. I wanted to maybe just give each of you an opportunity to impart one last bit of wisdom, if you'd like. David, do you have anything that you'd like to kind of contribute to that as we close?
I think I said everything that I had in my heart to say. I'm just honored to be sitting here with Ted, really, and learning. I feel like I'm in the crowd just listening to him. And yeah, that's it.
Wonderful.
Well, from my perspective, I just simply take so much heart from individuals like David, who are out there actually doing this stuff and transforming our sense of place and moving us into that trajectory of rethinking what our future is going to be. So I gained so much confidence from that. And I guess, you know, in terms of my longevity of having been at this for many decades, it gives me a lot of hope, and it gives me a lot of satisfaction, and validates that it's all worth it in the end, no no matter what the trials and tribulations have been. So also want to thank everybody here for coming out and listening, and hopefully you'll be able to get some takeaways from all of this, because I think that what is represented here is innovation and adaptation, and it has lessons for not our own selves, but for others as well, too. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah, it's been...
Party.
It's been a real great idea. It's been a real pleasure to meet with you both through the day with earlier with our staff and this evening with everyone who's gathered here today this evening and online. It really has been an opportunity where we've learned from you, shared lots of great ideas, and I believe we've all had our hearts touched by the work that you do. And had our eyes open. So thanks so much. Want to say thank you to all of our audience for coming tonight, both in person and online. I'd like to thank very much our whole team and our technical support for making it possible.
Especially the one that keeps giving me the peace sign back there all the time.
Indeed. So we hope to see you all in the fall as we start Urbanism Lab Season 10. And it'll be part of our 125th anniversary ceremonies. We also want to ensure that you get the post-event survey and that you take the time to fill that out. You could win one of our Remarkable Trees books. And just in closing, we have a special treat. We'd like to welcome Awema from Kitiganzibi to close our evening with a song. So thanks so much.
Hello, everybody. My name is Owen Matendesi. I'm Algonquin from Kitiganzibi, and thank you for having me here. So I'm going to send you guys off with a little traveling song. Hey, 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 hey